So then, Ironsworn. It is this it's a tabletop RPG of perilous quests. And it's somewhat of on the grittier nature. Got a nice dice resolution mechanic. In short, we are going to roll essentially three dice. Two challenge dice, d10s, one action die, a d6. Then to the d6, the so-called action die, we're going to add a bunch, get a final score, and compare it to the challenge die. And the number of challenge die we beat determines how great of a hit we made. And I've also set myself up with the World 20 sheet. So I don't see a great need to go into what exactly it is all about. So let's start to get going with it. There is also a nice campaign setup summary. Create character and create world. I'm probably going to be doing the world a bit before the character, so that we have something to set the character in. But they will also be interlinked with each other. Some background bonds, it's how we are connected to peoples, settlements, and so on. Then there is the first WoW that have been sworn. It's basically what our character's main quest is. Then we are going to envision the inciting incident, the things that sparks what is going to happen. And then from here, we are going to get going, setting the scene, swearing an iron vow, and all that. And then we are going to move on to actually play it. So the question is, should I just I'm going to print screen this just to make sure that I have it. So we don't need that anymore. I'm just opening up something. Well, GIMP, now that it pops up there, and just so I can have it. And now we can, with that there, we can get started. So, to create the world, we are actually going to dig to go directly into the so-called world workbook. It is what is on a why isn't my need that? Which is what's summarized on page 194 and so on. Apparently the PDF isn't synced with my programs. Counting of pages. Now I was thinking about, there is this part of the game world book, your truths about the world, the old world, and so on. It is also in this your world truths workbook. So, to put the old world a bit in context, the old world is the old world where we came from, into the new world 2 generations ago, and something in the old world have caused us to move on to, well, at least those who went to the new world, that drew them to the new world. So here are a few suggestions for the old world. Savage clans called the Skuld invaded the kingdoms of the old world. Our armies fell. Most were killed or taken into slavery. Those who escaped set a sail aboard. I'm not too interested in that. The sickness moved like a horrible wave across the old world, killing all in its path. Thousands fled aboard ships. Again, neither of those are really interesting in for me, because they mark such an abrupt transition from the old world. The third suggestion here. The old world could no longer sustain us. We were too large in number. We had felled the forests, our crops withered in the barren ground, the cities and villages overflowed with desperate, hungry people. At the king's battle for scraps, we cast our fate to the sea and found the Ironlands, a new world, a fresh start. I want to get going with that. But slightly revised, not that dour situation, but the old world could no longer sustain us. We had grown too large. Woods to heat our war homes have become scarce. Food no longer enough to sustain us all. And then the new world was discovered. Third, fourth children with no inheritance guaranteed. Built ships. Adventurers, the hungry, those who either had no future in the old world, or those who simply saw a future, a place to stake out their own, left the old world to the new one. Less of a migration than an exodus. Let's get a few notes down. So, old world. Cannot sustain us. New world found. The hungry. The third, fourth children. The adventurers. Set sail. The ones without future in the old, and those with the claim for the future to stake. Yeah, put their faith. on the new world. Claim. Oh, iron. Iron is what all walls are sweared upon. They are. It is important. Yeah. Some suggestions here. The imposing hills and mountains of the Ironlands are rich in iron ore. Most prized of it all is the Starforged Black Iron. I feel that this makes us in the new world pretty much we will come into the same situation as the old world sooner or later. We will grow large, become a multitude of people, and we'll exhaust the new world. But that will take probably generations. And while it is an interesting, not too sold of it, because the new world will become the same as the old world, and then perhaps we'll find another new world. Meh. The weather is bleak. Rain and wind sweep in from the ocean. The winters are long and bitter. One of the first settlers complained, only those made of iron dare live in this foul place, and thus our land was named. So this makes iron a bit more of a... not as physical a thing, but rather a mentality. Being hard as iron. Being able to endure pretty much anything. Again, I'm not too sold of it. Because the third one is really good. Inscrutable metal pillars are found throughout the land. They are iron gray and smooth as river stone. No one knows their purpose. Some say they are as old as the world. Some, such as the iron priests, worship them and swear vows upon them. Most make a warning sign and hurry along the way when they happen across one. The pillars does not tarnish, and even the sharpest blade cannot mark them. I really like these. It just straight up. There are these metal pillars. We don't know their purpose, how they came. And do we know? And apparently the sharpest blade cannot even mark them. Yeah, I really like it. It is mysterious. And I like those things. So iron. I'm just going to copy this straight in here, because why reinvent the wheel? I like the quest starter as well. Your dreams are haunted by visions of a pillar which stands in an unfamiliar landscape. What do you see? Why are you sworn to seek it out? That quest starter is an option for us. Legacies. It's about... yeah. We are the first humans to walk these lands. Perhaps we are. I'm not sure. Other humans sailed here from the old world untold years ago, but all that is left of them is savage fear of people we call the Broken. It's their fate to become our own. Before the Ironlanders, before even the firstborn, another people lived here. The ancient runes are found throughout the Ironlands. Not keen on either. So so, Joel. No, it's not my own setting. It's a bit. It's creating a setting out from some seeds. That gives options for some rough pictures for the setting, and then we can fill them in a bit more. What is the legacy of these lands? I have an idea that I actually have read this beforehand, that ties into some things a bit later on. So I'm actually going to leave the legacy alone for now. Perhaps there is perhaps something else pop up that will. It will inspire communities. We are few in number, these accursed lands. Most rarely have contact with anyone outside our own small standing or village, and strangers are viewed with deep suspicion. We live in communities called circles. These are settlements ranging in size from a standing with a few families to a village of several hundred. Some circles belong to nomadic folk. Some powerful circles might include a cluster of settlements. We trade and sometimes feud with other circles. We have forged the Ironlands into a home. Villages within the havens are connected by well-trod roads. Trade caravans travel between settlements in the havens and those in outlying regions. Even so, much of this land is untamed. I enjoyed the third one, where it makes it less inhospitable, less dreadful. We have actually a bit conquered these lands, which actually ties slightly back into this iron suggestion. The imposing hills and mountains of the Ironlands are rich in iron ore. That we have erected some history, but there are iron and metals in the hills. Why wouldn't there? But not that it is that makes iron with the capital I special. But I prefer this option. About the communities, that there are larger these havens, and there is trade, there is commerce, people travel. Yeah, much more fun than it being more or less uninhabited. So I'm just going to take a look and see if there is how much. The rule book says about havens. Oh, havens are a part of the. It's one region. Let's see, do I have a map of the setting? Just a blank map. Does that tell us anything? No. However, there should be a map in the core rulebook. Is it in the back? No. Yeah, I'm currently looking through the preview of the page, see, because I know there should be one somewhere. Yes, here. Yeah, Havens is region number 5. This eastern central part. So let's put up the blank map. The Havens are this part here. So basically, within the Havens, we have created a civilization. That is where we have settled the most. The rest is rough, unclaimed. This region here, that is just beyond the Haven, the deep wilds. Sounds wild. Then we have the hinterlands, the Tempest Hills, the Veiled Mountains. Or here is flooded lands, the ragged coast, barrier islands. Yeah, deep wilds. Unbroken woodland, thick canopy, and haven. Rolling hills, rocky bluffs, pockets of dense wood, thick with shadow, walled settlements, verdant hearts, wide rivers navigated by weary boatmen, long, harsh winters. Yeah, I think that focusing on the havens is interesting. Yeah, having made that into a real home. The buildings we live in are not just wooden structures. We are building even small hamlets out of stone. The roads between villages are more than just paths. Perhaps some are even marked by large cairns, way stations are erected along these roads where travelers can seek shelter from the weather. The quest starter here also is interesting. A settlement has fallen under the unjust rule of a cruel leader. What leverage do they hold over these people? What's your connection to the community? What can be done to overthrow this tyrant? It also makes it a bit more social, and not just traveling through the wilderness. So, back to working out the world. Next part is leaders. What is the truth about leadership? Leadership is as varied as the people. Some communities are governed by the head of powerful families, or they have a council of elders who make decisions and settle disputes. In others, the priests hold sway. For some, it is duels in the circle to the side. Each of our communities has its own leader called an overseer. Every seventh spring, the people affirm the current overseer or choose a new one. Some overseers wear the iron circlet reluctantly, while others thirst for power and gain it through schemes or threats. Numerous clan chiefs rule over petty domains. Most are intent on becoming the one true king. The squabbles will be our undoing. I like that one. So, imagine this. We are coming to this land, having been basically left on the wayside of the old. Yeah, it's harsh, it's cold, it's unforgiving, but we are claiming it. Within the havens, villages are being connected, trade and commerce are starting. The land is being claimed and dominated, and we no longer have to struggle against the land that much, so we find something else to struggle against. Each other. So, leaders. And so, how do we hold ourselves together? How do we defend our lives? Here in the Ironlands, supplies are too precious and lands are too sparsely populated to support organized fighting forces. When a community threatened, the people stand together to protect their own. The wardens are our soldiers, guards, militia. They serve their communities by standing sentry, patrolling the surrounding land, and organizing defenses in times of crises. Most have strong ties to the community, others called free wardens or wandering mercenaries who hire to serve a community or protect caravans. Our warbands are rallied to strike at our enemies or defend our holdings, though nearly as impressive as the armies that once marched across the old world. These forces are well trained and equipped as their communities can manage. The banners of the warbands are adorned with depictions of the old world history and Ironland victories. So, we are building up this idea of community settlements, organization as well. While the first one definitely is in effect, yes. When a community is threatened, the people stand together to protect their own. Yes. I don't think the wardens. I think they are a bit too do-goody. But I actually think that the primary force is the warbands. These petty kings, they have their retinues, their champions, their sworn men. Remember a bit about the old world, when that adventurers, those who want to stake a claim on the future. One way to stake a claim is to swear allegiance to someone more powerful. Find a king. Swear allegiance to them, serve them well, and you can be rewarded with a fief of your own. I think this is the how many of these warbands are still filled up. There are a lot of unclaimed land. So serve King well. And be awarded a small settlement to as a pension. Something to rule and to rule in their stead. And then when crisis come, the warbands are rallied. However, I don't think the banners of the warbands are adorned with the depictions of their old world history. I don't think they really have a connection to the old world. Perhaps at first, it may be the fourth son of some king who brought some of their retinue with them. But not anymore. These have been, it's two generations ago. These warbands have been merged and split and merged again. So I'm going to remove that. Now are done with their Ironland victories. And now we get into the really fun stuff. Mysticism, religion and so on. Some still find comfort in the old ways. They call mystics to divine the fortune of their newborn or ask them to perform rituals to invoke a bountiful harvest. Others act out of fear against those who they suspect of having power. However, most folk believe true magic, if it even existed, is lost to us now. Magic is rare and dangerous, but those few who wield the power are truly gifted. Magic crosses through this land as the rivers flow through the hills. The power is there for those who choose to harness it, and even the common folk often know a helpful ritual or two. I like more the very, very low magic, mystics divine future of newborn, rituals for bountiful harvest. It's those things that the magic that is controlled do. It's small, I wouldn't call it small, but much less impactful than tossing fireballs. However, after the religion one, I'm going to revise this a bit because I have some ideas for religion. So, religion. A few Ironlanders still make signs and mumble prayers out of habit or tradition, but most believe the gods long ago abandoned us. The people honor gods old and new in this harsh land of prayer is a simple but powerful comfort. Our gods are many. I'm going with a completely new one. The gods. There's no prayers from this far away land. Our pleas goes unanswered. When we left the old world, we left the gods. And tying this back into mysticism, there was a different form of religion. More of an animist approach, more spirit worship here. Since the gods don't hear the prayers, but invoking rites for a bountiful harvest is, it works. So you can say your prayers to the spirit of the fields, and invoke a right to appease them. Good luck charms and such things. That is the way religion has gone into mysticism. So we're going to revise this a little bit. Some find comfort in new ways. They call mystics to divine the fortune of the newborn, or ask them to perform rituals to invoke a bountiful harvest. Others act out of fear against those would they suspect of having power. Yeah, because why? Yeah, because having this power to invoke a bountiful harvest when the gods aren't answering, where has the power of the gods gone, and why are these people gifted with power similar to the gods? So there is a bit of skepticism and fear against these mystics as well. Could we add something more about it? That is the question. No. Let's see. Yeah, fear of being cursed. Yeah, lots of the fear of mystics is that no longer is it a god who is responsible for it. It's just a man. And a man can be corrupt, a man can be swayed. A man is at fault. The gods, they're greater than men. Perhaps in the old world, while priests could call upon the favor of the gods, it was never the priest that was doing miracles. It was the gods imposing themselves in the material world. The gods did the miracles, not the priests. And now we have men, women doing these things instead. Yeah, that is good. So, that is then the firstborn. These are, well, let's see who they are. The firstborn have passed into legend. Some say the remnants of the old tribe still dwell in deep forests or high mountains. Most believe they were never anything more than a myth. The firstborn live in isolation and are fiercely protective of their own lands. The Firstborn holds sway in the Ironlands. The Elves of the Deep Forests and the Giants of the Hills tolerate us and even trade with us for now. Ironlanders fear the day they decide we are no longer welcome here. I think the Firstborn are still here. The Firstborn are not humans, so to say, but rather special. I think that when we came here, the Firstborn did. We did not come to a land where the inhabitants were isolationists. So I think that the Firstborn, or are they in isolation? No, actually, I'm going to go with the first one. So, the first one have passed into legend. Some say the remnants of the old tribe still dwell in deep forests or high mountains. Most believe they were never anything more than myth. We have a myth about the Firstborn. Perhaps we even have how we place ourselves in the world. Perhaps these myths about the Firstborn never really tell how they looked, but rather just name them the Firstborn of the mountains, the Firstborn born of the forests, the Firstborn of the fields. And but they haven't passed into legend. We just don't recognize them. Must believe they were never anything more than myth. Truth is, they are still here. We just don't recognize them. So, what about beasts? The beasts of old are nothing but legend. You would travel into the deep forests and high mountains, return with wild tales of monstrous creatures, but they are obviously delusional. No such things exist. Monstrous beasts stalk the wild areas of the Ironlands. Beasts of all sorts roam the Ironlands. They dwell primarily in reaches, but range into settled lands to hunt. There they often prey on cattle, but attacks on travelers' caravans or even settlements are not unknown. I like the third one. It is something where the people of the Ironlands can unite against, if that social angle is to be followed. Where is the reaches, by the way? Doesn't say here. Islands, Winterlands, Wild Coast, Templed Stills, Deep Wilds, Wailed Mountains, Flooded Hills, Shattered Wastes, Havens. So let's see. Beaches. I think that reaches here should just imply far away. Yeah, the extreme limits. Yeah. The beasts of all sorts roamed Ireland. They dwell primarily in the reaches. Here we should, in the wild lands, but range into the settled lands to hunt. Of course they do. We pen up cattle for them, like serving up a smorgasbord. And then, sometimes warbands are called against the beasts to drive them off. So warbands are not just to wage war against each other, but also to drive off the beasts. Horrors. Horrors are different from beasts. I think that there is a bit of a creature codex. Yeah, foes, beasts, like basilisks, elder beasts. Yeah, elder wolf spears and such. Spiders, leviathan, mammoths, wyverns. The beasts are natural to the land. Beasts are monstrous creatures, just of great size and power. They are natural beings, not supernatural entities that were unknown in the old world. Yeah. Yeah. Imagine giant bears, elder basilisks, dire spiders, those things. Horrors are supernatural entities. In the old world, they were superstition and legend. Here, they are nightmares made real. The Ironlands is fertile ground for darkness and evil to take hold, spawning those undead beings of pure vengeance or mindless hate. Many horrors can be temporarily defeated through physical attacks, but can't be killed. They are beyond death. Bone walkers. Yeah. Chimeras. Frostbound. Frostbound. Haunt. That's basically ghosts, hollows. Yeah, horrors, undeads, basically. So, are there undeads? What are the options? Nothing but stories to frighten children. We are wary of dark forests and deep waterways, for monsters lurk in those places. In the depths of the long night, when all is wrapped in darkness, only fools venture beyond their homes. The dead do not rest in the Ironlands. At night we light torches, scatter salt, and post sentries at the gate. It is not enough. They are coming. I think that horrors are real, but they are not very common. Option 2 is the one I feel is appropriate. Dark forests, deep waterways. I can also imagine tomes, etc. And during winter, when the sun doesn't come up, people stay at home. So that is the basics of our little world here. To review it. The old world, it cannot sustain us all. People are going hungry. Even rich ones are left without means to sustain themselves. Third, fourth children won't get an inheritance. But then unclaimed land was found. So those who had no future would I think many worked off their transit debt. They said they worked for these new lands for 10-20 years in exchange for passage. Because if you only travel with adventurers, men at arms, third, fourth sons who expect to rule, who is going to till the soil, who is going to build homes. At least half of all those who traveled over did so not to really stake a claim on the new land, but to find a better life, to be able to sustain their families, to grow a bit more food than they were able in the old world. Became serfs for 10-20 years. After that, they were free. Many remained because they had put down roots. Their longhouses constructed, their cattle herd grown. So they remained. And then there were the third, fourth children with no inheritance to claim, who took what they could and went over to stake a claim. Adventurers following these people, perhaps not with as much means, but perhaps they had a sword and shield, so they became men at arms. And then iron, this thing that is so important to the world. It's these inscrutable metal pillars that are found throughout the land. Iron grays, smooth as river stone. No one knows their purpose. They are being worshipped as things, as ancient things. It's also thing people swear vows upon. Question is, can we harvest these iron pillars? Perhaps that's where mysticism comes in, where the mystics can remove their protections around them. Perhaps. No, I'm not sure about it. Or perhaps, once they are removed from the ground, they can be put in a forge. Yeah, I think that. And so, they can be made into weapons, they can be made into other iron things. Yeah, legacies. Never talked about that. We are the first humans to walk these lands. First humans. All the humans sailed here from the old world until years ago, but all that's left of them is savage fear of people. Before the Iron Islanders, before even the firstborn and other people lived here, their ancient ruins are found throughout the Iron Lands. Wait. Firstborn have passed into legend. Some say the remnants of the old tribes still that dwell in deep forest or high mountains. Most believe they were never anything more than myth. Truth is, they are still here. We just don't recognize them. I think we came from this place in an age long ago, an age of legends. Legacies. We came from here. An exodus during the age of legend. Now we have returned from where we came, but we don't know it yet. So yeah, it was perhaps a mass exodus. Perhaps all humans left. Were we driven out? Did we leave voluntarily? So, yeah, it's actually quite interesting, this. Why did we leave? And how will we realize we have returned? I think Iron had a starting quest. Your dreams are haunted by visions of a pillar which stands in an unfamiliar landscape. What do you see? Why are you sworn to seek it out? Perhaps this is the question we are supposed to answer. How will we realize we have returned? We have been given a dream by a pillar which stands in an unfamiliar landscape. Yes. That is the great background. Wow, we will swear. I will find this pillar in the unknown. Place that haunts my visions, my dreams. It's epic. I'll get back to this, that. It is something central to all of mankind. So of course it is epic. So with that done. So we'll put that up there, and we'll continue. Communities. We have forged Ironlands into home. Well, the haven. This part here. We have forged into a home. We have forged it into home so much that the community leaders are naming themselves king. Have created war bands to defend themselves. The more glory they have, the greater their war band. And we should change religion mysticism's place. The gods hear no prayers from this faraway land. We left them. We left them when we left the old world. And so comfort have been found in new ways. Mystics divines the fortune of the newborn. Or perform rituals to invoke a bountiful harvest. But these new powerful men and women also invoke a fair amount of fear. Where gods were greater than man, these who wield powers now are but men. And men are fallible. The firstborn a peasant legend. Some say the remnants of the old tribes still dwell in deep forests or high mountains. Most believe they were never anything more than myth. Yet, and this ties into the this Exodus tale, where the old ones caused our Exodus. And then we left, and the firstborn turned into legends, into myths. Yeah, the truth is they're still here. We just don't recognize them. If we go back to the world workbook about the firstborns. They mentioned elves, giants, as firstborns. Perhaps we expect the firstborns to look like us. Yeah. The myths, legends, they look like us. When we picture them, they are like us. Except they are just another form of, they are another tribe, and so on. That's still us, fundamentally, and that's why we don't recognize the firstborn that are here. Beasts of all sorts roamed Ironlands. They dwell primarily in the reaches, but range into settled lands to hunt. Yeah. We are presenting them a smorgasbord. So they, of course, they come and they take a nibble. And Horus, down dead, dark forests, deeper waterways, hidden caves, and so on. So between the Exodus and when we came a couple of generations ago, there were no humans here. Are all of the undead so old they are from pre-Exodus? Or perhaps the Exodus wasn't complete? Where do they come from? Well, we'll find should we go up against them. And that's it for the world building.